If you've got your Bibles, let's turn to Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6, we're going to be today. If you don't have a Bible, raise your hand and someone from our guest services team will be happy to bring you one. You can use it this morning. And if you don't have a Bible or would just like a new one, then you can keep it. It's our gift to you. We've been talking about starting this parenting series for a few weeks. I'm excited about starting it today. And I know some of you are like, I'm not a parent. So this doesn't really apply to me. So I got to skip out of church for the next 4 weeks. Some of you are like, you know, my kids are grown now, so I'm kind of done with the whole parenting thing. So that's good. I can sleep in the next 4 Sundays. Some of you may say, I'm not a parent yet. All right. So I'm not sure if I should be taking notes now or after I have the kid. And I get there could be some very different perspectives about what this series and how much it'll apply to you. But here's what I'm confident of. Right. Just as we watched in that video. You're not too old, you're not too young, right? There's really no circumstance or situation in this room where there's not someone who is watching you, paying attention to you, looking at you. And as you set an example and follow the example of our Father, they can see and learn from you. Just as we'll talk about parents pouring into their kids, we all have the opportunity to be an influencer in people around our lives. So don't think that this parenting series doesn't apply to you. I just hang on, all right? And I believe that you will find lessons and you will see how it's still, the truth still applies, no matter where you are, right? No matter where you are in life. What do I do with my phone? Anybody got a smartphone? You guys have a smartphone? You guys want to like take a picture and like put it on Instagram real quick? Anybody? No, I'm just kidding. Don't do that. Use it for your Bible, right? You know what's interesting to me? Like this. Okay, this phone. I like this phone. I like it. It's pretty big. It's gigantic. Feels like having an iPad up to my ear. It's pretty large. But this is a newer phone. So 2 years ago, I had a different phone. It's much different. Does anybody have the same phone you had like in 1999? Anybody still using their phone from 1999? You are? Really? That's awesome. High five, dude. That's awesome. Okay. Whew. I had my phone. It was a big brick. Had a giant battery. It had an antenna pulled out of it. It wasn't one of the cool ones. It had like the flip down thing. It was just a giant little brick thing. I remember the first time I got a phone with a color screen, and it wasn't really color. It just wasn't gray. So it was just like bluish, you know, which I guess qualified. I'm not sure. I've seen technology change so much over the last 20 years, and I know that as much technology is in this little device. I mean, this is amazing. Like, there's more technology in this thing than there was used to put a man on the moon. At least that's so I've heard. I know that I used to have a GPS device in my car. Now I use this for GPS. I used to carry a camera and a video camera. And several other devices. Now it's all in one thing, right? Just the other day, we needed someone to do a coin toss, but no one had a coin. So I actually downloaded an app, and it flipped a coin, like on the screen. That's all I did was just flip the coin. Yay, okay, heads or tails, call it, ding. All right, I used my phone to flip a coin. So like I can do so many things with my phone. But I know, as advanced as this is, they're going to come out with a newer version in a couple years, and it's going to make this one kind of obsolete. And even if I kind of hold on to this and try to keep it as long as I can, eventually the company will like stop supporting it. So like now I can't update anything. Right? You ever had that happen on your phone? It's like I had an old phone and now I can't even use it anymore because nothing works on it. It's kind of frustrating, right? It's frustrating. It's so, you know, it's expensive, great technology. You would think that the companies would just, you know, they would make it future-proof. They would say, look, here's a device. This is awesome. You'll be able to use this. We're just always going to upgrade. We're always going to update it. You'll always be able to use that. What a great investment. But they don't, because they want you to spend money. They want you to keep buying stuff. And so they don't future-proof it. They don't put into it what it needs so that you can use it forever. And with that same truth can be applied to parenting styles and how we parent our kids, how we treat our kids, how we raise our kids. In fact, there are very few people in this room that are currently raising their children the same way children were raised in the 50s or the 1850s, right? Or the 70s. I mean, you could go 50 years or 100 years into the future and you'll see that it'll change even again. that everyone has an opinion. Everyone wants to point the finger and say, you're not raising your kids the way you should, right? Which oftentimes means the way that I am, right? That we see the world, Eastern culture, Western culture, have very different opinions about how children should be raised. There are so many books written about parenting. It's just constantly changing. It's constantly being updated. There's constantly books being published to try to tell you the new proper way to raise your kids, or the way that's better than the last book that was published. In fact, I did a search because I wanted to see, and I want to know how many books exist on parenting, because you can go to the bookstore and there's a whole section on parenting books. So I looked on Amazon, did a real quick search on Amazon, and this will be fun. Let's just put it out there. If you absolutely know the answer because you were here in the early service, don't just throw it out there. But can you do a wild guess? Just anybody, can throw out a guess. If you search parenting book in Amazon, how many titles come up? Anyone want to guess? 1,200 higher. A million. That's a little high. That's too. That's a large guess. 130,000 parenting books. 130,000 parenting books. Here's what that means. Math wise, right? That means if we spread that number out over 25 years, okay, in the last 25 years, that means that there would have been 15 different books published every day on parenting. That's a little nuts, right? That's a lot of different opinions on parenting. Now, sure, they probably share some ideas, and some different people have shared some opinions on things, but that says two things to me. It says that, one, that the market is extremely saturated, and that everyone has an opinion, right? That parenting is extremely subjective, but it also says that there's a demand. Like book companies would not continue to publish books on parenting if parents were not buying these books up to try to figure out how to parent. Because I don't know about you, but when I had my first child, he did not also come out with an instruction manual. Like when I open a box and a new TV in a plastic bag, it tells me how to plug things in and where things are to go. That didn't come out with the baby. It wasn't there. It wasn't a part of the birth process. And everything was just kind of figuring it out, right? It blows my mind that you have to take a test to get a driver's license to drive a car. You have to take a test to go to college. But anybody can be a parent. I mean, there you go. Good luck. And so I get that people are writing books. I get that people have something to say. And I remember how freaked out I was. And so, sure, yeah, if there's an expert that can tell me, you know, step by step how to best parent my child, then sure, give me the book. And I'll figure, you know, maybe I'll read the first couple of chapters and think I got a hang of whatever. But it's a saturated market. A lot of different opinions. But the most interesting thing about all the books is that there's no empirical data. Most of them are a single person or a couple people who say, this is what I think. There's no like real data or science or study to prove their way, their method. They'll point to different studies and say, see, look, this is kind of evidence to what we think is the right way. But they just kind of put it out like, this is the right way. This is how I did it. In fact, I'll give you a couple of examples of some books that I thought were very interesting as I looked up some fairly recent ones. Because it used to be, you know, just 10 years ago, there were like 75,000 books. So there's almost twice as many books now on Amazon. But you would read, you'd read What to Expect When Expecting. Everybody read that? Everybody have a copy of that one? All right. Or What to Expect Your First Year. And then maybe you would read How to Talk So Kids Will Listen, or Listen So Kids Will Talk. That's the classic book, right? But a lot of different books and opinions out there. One in particular was published in 2008 called Free Range Kids. Have you heard about this one? This is great. It actually started from an article written by Lenore Skenazy. She's also author of the book. The article was Why I Let My 9-Year-Old Ride the Subway Alone. See, you guys are freaking out. Like, no way. That's not right. In fact, there was even a news story just a couple months ago about parents that were arrested because they let their kids like walk to the park or something that was a mile from their house, and the kids got picked up and taken to DFACS, and they're like, you can't just let your kids wander, you know, you got to have parental supervision at all times. So this author was like, no, man, we're protecting our kids too much. It's actually doing more harm than good. And it was a national bestseller. I mean, it was a millions of copies sold. Big deal. People were like, yeah, I just want to let my kids range. Just let them go. All right. In 2011, a Chinese author, Amy Cho, wrote an article in the Wall Street Journal, which then turned into a book as well. And her article was, Why Chinese Mothers Are Superior. That's great, right? And she got the nickname Tiger Mom because people were a little critical of her perspective on parenting. And what her book did, what the article really sparked, was this debate over the way Eastern culture raises children and the way Western culture raises children. And she was like saying, okay, you Americans, your kids are lazy and they're fat and they're disrespectful and they don't appreciate authority. But in Eastern culture, our kids are smart and they're well-behaved and they're good at math, and so, because we give them structure and we give them rules. We put them in boxes and they have consequences. And so her idea of structure and rules and consequences was this big idea. It was revolutionary. It's like, wow, we should raise our kids like the Chinese people raise their kids. And so it was a big book. In 2012, a Time magazine, you guys may have seen this, it was a fairly controversial cover of Time magazine, an article written about the ideas and teachings of a Dr. Bill Sears. It was called Are You Mom Enough? And it was this idea of attachment parenting, right? And if you remember the cover of Time, it was like a lot of the conversation was about how long you should breastfeed, and so the picture of the cover was like a 7-year-old still breastfeeding. That was the cover, if you remember. And the idea of attachment parenting here was is saying, look, you just need to satisfy all of your kids' needs, right? You don't need to you just need to keep them close. You don't let the world corrupt them or let them stray away too much. And so people bought it. It's like, this is great. This is awesome. This is exactly how I'm going to raise my kids. And it was huge. It was a big national movement, big national seller in the book. Another one just last year, Bringing Up Bebe, by Pamela Druckerman. She was, her baby was born in France, and she was mesmerized by how French kids seem to be well-behaved, but also creative. They seem to have a little bit more freedom, but also structure. And so she wrote about how French parents are the best parents. And that was her book, about how parents really just need to stop stressing, they need to worry less, they need to hover less, they need to do less, simplify your lives. You don't need to have your kids in all these sports activities and do all these different things. And so that was a big deal. It was a huge book in a lot of countries. It re-sparked the debate about different cultures having the right idea of parenting. Well, the problem with all of these books, the problem with all of these ideas is they're just ideas. And we can get people to kind of buy, yes, I'm going to try that, I'm going to do that. And it fluctuates. And there's this ebb and this flow of what's being published and what's being pushed and what expert says what. And you get these one-person perspective opinions that people like and they spread and they go viral and they catch fire. But none of them are future-proof. What we need for parenting is a future-proof option, something that we can hold on to for generations to come, that not just for our family, but for our children's family. And it needs to be something that is time-tested, that's proven, something that we can see has worked. And I'm fairly confident you guys kind of know where I'm going with this. Like, there is a future-proof option. There is a future-proof option for your family, and it's God's Word. And I think most of you would agree. I think most of you would say, yes, if God's Word is the foundation for our family, then we can instill that in our kids, and our kids will instill that in their kids. And you've seen it work for thousands of years. You've seen it time-tested. You've seen it proven. You've seen the results. It's great. Like, if God's Word is the foundation of the family, God's blessing is it's rich, it's thick, it's true, it's real. However, according to all the statistics, a big study done by the Barna Group, even if we believe that's true, we're failing at making that true. This is the future-proof option. To not just teach our kids the fad parenting style, to not just do what we think is right now, but what is right forever. What is right for their children and for their grandchildren and so on. what was right before, what will be right in the future, forever. This is the future-proof option. It doesn't matter when you buy in. When you buy in, it's the same. Yesterday, today, forever. But statistically, we're failing our families. I want to read you some statistics. Because I want you to see that as much as we can believe that this provides the clear principles we need to honor God, advance His purposes, see lives transformed, the statistics show that our kids are not getting it. So a big survey done by the Barna Group a couple years ago, it found that the survey group was 8 to 12-year-olds. It found that 36% of the children surveyed, this national survey, 36% of the children believe that the Bible is not trustworthy, that it's just a book. And this is a big survey. This is a big deal. A lot of kids. Something that they even stopped at one point in time because they weren't even sure that they needed to provide more information because there were so many books on parenting, there were so many opinions on parenting. The Barna Group sort of stepped back and said, no, I think this is important, especially for those who believe that this is the best option. 19% of the children surveyed don't think that it's, only 19% think that it's important to tell people about God. Less than 1 in 5. 46%, not even half, say that their faith is important to them. 58% say that God is not all-knowing and all-powerful. What's fascinating about these statistics is that if you poll adults, these numbers are much higher. For children and their honesty, 33% believe Jesus came back to life. So two-thirds don't believe in the resurrection, foundational doctrine of the church. And just over half, most of the kids survey say that they know everything of significance in the Bible, so there's no reason to study it anymore. There's no reason to read anymore about this. Now, we are always one generation away from a great revival or a great revolution. We know that every great revival in history has started to some extent with young people. And it could be our children's generation, your children's generation, that makes a significant impact in this community or in this country or around the globe with the gospel of Jesus Christ, that prove God's love in such a magnificent and fantastic way that hundreds, thousands, millions of people come to know Christ through it. But not with statistics like this. You've probably heard that anywhere from 80 to 90% of children that do not have a solid foundation of faith before they're 18 never come to a faith in Jesus Christ. That's a staggering statistic. But the age group that is most receptive to the truth is the age group surveyed. The age group most receptive to the truth are the ones who are saying they don't believe it. Why? Well, the experts of the survey, and I would say, is because they don't see it in their parents. Because their parents don't think it's important to tell people about God. And their parents don't believe the Bible is trustworthy. The parents do not believe God is all-powerful, all-knowing. The enormous burden and responsibility that we bear as parents to give our children the truth is a huge responsibility, but it is one that God has given us. And so I want us to look at Ephesians chapter 6, There are many passages in the Bible on being a parent, right? And pouring into your kids and the benefit that kids can be for their parents and what it means to honor your mother and father, what it means to obey your parents. This short little passage in Ephesians could be cross-referenced to almost every one of those other passages. And so this four verses, we're gonna look at it today. I'm going to pull out three truths this morning, but we're going to break it down even deeper over the next couple weeks and see the value and importance of being godly parents who are choosing to future-proof their family with the gospel of Jesus Christ. So chapter 6, Ephesians, verse 1. We'll read to verse 4. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you and that you may live long in the land. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Now, if you read that and you're kind of paying attention, you're like, well, two-thirds of that is about children. What does that have to do with parents? And the last section just talks about fathers. Doesn't even say anything about mothers. Well, this passage is very much about family. It is very much about the responsibility of parents. Now, we'll see that today, and we're going to pull it apart even more over the next couple weeks. And there is an emphasis on fathers in the last verse because, men, listen to me. We really bear the burden of the spiritual leadership in our family. Now, I know that there are women here who are attending this church whose husbands are not with them, because they're not being the man they're supposed to be. Now, if that's you, if you're here, woman, if you're here and your man is not here, he needs to be here next week for Father's Day, all right? Beg him, bribe him with Krispy Kreme donuts, because that's what we're having for donuts with dads. Do something, get him here next week. There will be an emphasis on the role of the man in the house over the next couple of weeks, because men, that's a part of it. That's the biblical model. And the video you watched about walking in his shoes, we have the example of our father to follow in his shoes. We're supposed to be that example to our family and to our kids. And if we're not being that example, we're putting that burden on them to figure it out or for mom to do it. Then what are we doing? It has been given to us men to lead the house. That's why Paul and many other places of Scripture, it points specifically to men disciplining and instructing your children in the way of the Lord, according to his word. So we'll talk about that a lot over the next couple of weeks. Get your men here if they're not here. And men, be here, because you need to hear it. It's important. We cannot skirt this. We cannot be lazy about it. We cannot be apathetic. We have to take it seriously. So let me pull out three truths from this passage just to show you that it is all about parents. It is all about family. And not just your family, but your children's family and the family of God as well. So right in the beginning, it says, children, obey your parents. And the first thing you'll see is that for a future-proof family knows that parenting is the responsibility of the parents. Let me say that again, because I know it may sound a little redundant. Yeah, a future-proof family knows that parenting is the responsibility of the parents. Well, yeah, duh, right? Parenting is the responsibility of parents. Yeah, well, okay. Except the reason that all these books exist that tell you how to parent is because they think you need their help. The reason that the school systems around the country and here are a little secretive about what they're teaching is because, well, you're not the expert, and you don't really know what's best for your kids. The world will say that you need their help, right? You're not smart enough or good enough as a parent to do it the best way. And so you need your kids in public school. You need your kids in certain environments. You need to follow these particular regulations and rules and things because you're not getting it. And you don't know what's best. And we're telling you. That's what the world says. But God says, no, children are a gift. And along with that gift is the responsibility of the parents to take the responsibility seriously and parent. That's why it doesn't say, children, obey me. Children, do right. Children, be good and follow the Ten Commandments. That's not what it says. It says, children, what? Obey your parents. Why? Because parents have to set the structure for the children to follow. Parents have to know what they're supposed to obey, which means that parents have to know what they're supposed to obey. Parents have the responsibility to be parents, to know God's word and to teach God's word and to give it to them properly. You cannot, listen to me, you cannot rely on the church to teach your kids about Jesus. If that's all your children are getting, and so Sunday morning you drop them off and you're like, whew, okay, I get a break for my kids a little bit. I can put with a preacher speaking for an hour, but I can just not have my kids around me for an hour. It's awesome. And that's all your kids get of the Bible is what they hear over there on Sunday. Poor children. You can't rely on the church. You can't rely on the school. We know how important it is. We know how valuable it is. That's why we invest so much in our children's area to do as much as we can. Because if we get your kids for an hour, if you're willing to come and drop your kids off, we're going to soak them full as much as we possibly can. Because we know that so many of them don't get it at home. But that's also why I'm talking about it right now. So that changes. You cannot rely on your church. You cannot rely on the school. You cannot rely on your neighbors. You can't rely on your parents. You have to be the parent. You have to take responsibility. You have to teach your children what they're supposed to obey, which means that you have to know what you're supposed to obey so they learn properly. The second truth you see in the second verse, honor your father and mother, honor your parents. A future-proof family has a proper perspective. See, honor, integrity, character is not something that ever ends. Obeying your parents, right? Well, your kids, the world will say that, I mean, you pour into your kids until they're grown and they're gone. I mean, do the best you can, right? I mean, you have the responsibility to parent your kids really because the kid exists and that responsibility is on you because you had the kid. So there you go, right? So you have to do something. And you have to do something until they're adults and they can do it on their own. That's what the world says. But God says, no, it's deeper than that. It's a much bigger perspective. It's not just about you. It's not just about your family now. It's about your kids' family in the future. It's also about the family that you came from. See, obeying your parents, right? You're eventually going to grow up. You're eventually going to leave your parents' home. You're eventually going to make your own decisions. And so the obeying your parents, it kind of shifts when you leave your mother and you cleave to your spouse. But the honor your mother, your father, never stops. So how do your children learn how to honor you? They watch you honor your parents. And they watch you honor God. They watch you worship. They watch you praise him. They watch you pray to him. You want your kids to honor you? You have to teach them honor. How do you teach them honor? You show them honor. You demonstrate integrity and character. And it's not just about your family. It's also about the family of God. So they see that it's not something temporary, just while they're in your house, but it's something they continue for the rest of their life. As long as you're alive, and then they pour into their kids, so it never stops. That's future-proof. If it's just for your kids, and it ends, that's a new model when they start raising their kids, and it's done. A future-proof family has a proper perspective. Let me add this too. So you have to remember, okay, God created each and every one of us very special, very unique, all individual, right? But he created us all in his image. And oftentimes as parents, people poke fun at me a lot because my youngest son has long hair, right? And I have no hair. And so people say that I vicariously live through my youngest son's hair. Maybe I do. I don't know. I never had long curly hair, so I don't know. All right. I wasn't really an athlete growing up. I danced and sang on stage, and my son plays basketball, and so some people say I vicariously lived through my son's athletic ability because I don't really have any. I don't know if that's true, right? But here's what I do know, that there are plenty of parents who pour into their kids the image of them, right? Your children are created in the image of God. Raise your children in the image of God, not in the image of you. Raise your children to honor God. Raise your children to understand what it means to honor God. And if they get honoring God and you teach them to honor God, they will honor you. But if you teach them to just honor you, they never understand how to honor God. That's not real integrity. It's not real character. It's not godly character. Your children were created in the image of God. Don't raise them in your image. All right, the third truth. A future-proof family has an eternal priority. And we see this in the fourth verse. Bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. What does it mean to bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord? What is the discipline and instruction of the Lord? See, here's really the most critical point for this entire series. Because if I tried to tell you there was one hard and fast set way for you to raise your kids, I'd be lying to you. Because every child is different. Every family's different, right? To think that there has to be one specific way that you raise your children, a step-by-step process, is to think that every family household is the same, that it's cookie-cutter box. That's not true. God didn't make you that way. He didn't make me that way. But what God gave us, though, is a very clear truth. And that eternal priority must be a part of our parenting. It must be the foundation of our parenting. Let me tell you what I'm talking about. The discipline and instruction of the Lord is this. God created everything perfect, the way it was supposed to be, and we broke it. The discipline for breaking his perfect creation is death. The consequence for sin is eternal separation from God. That is the consequence. You have kids, they do something wrong, there's a punishment, there's a consequence. You're trying to teach them, right? The discipline of the Lord is, hey, you messed up, and there's a consequence for that. The instruction of the Lord is that there's redemption and there is hope. The instruction of the Lord is that if you believe in what God has done, that as he looked at his perfect creation, he got so frustrated that it was broken and he couldn't have a relationship with the world he created because it was stained with sin. And he said, I've got a way out. I'm going to come. And it's going to take a while, but I'm going to come. And I'm going to pay the price and the penalty for this. All right? I will take on the consequence so that I might have my people back, my children back, that they might be called sons of God. Adopt them as my own and redeem us back into this relationship that he wanted all along. The discipline and instruction of the Lord is that eternal priority, not only for us, but for our children. I know that there's not a single parent in here that wants to see their kids separated with the goats. There's no one here that wants to see their children not have saving faith. And the foundation of a future-proof family are parents that have that eternal priority. They are pouring into their kids the truth of God's word. They are pouring into their kids the truth of the gospel. I mean, I can ask the question, do you believe you're doing enough for your children? For those of you who are not parents, do you believe you're doing enough for your neighbor? Do you believe you're doing enough for your coworker, for your friend, for your family? Do you believe you're doing enough to have that eternal priority in mind? Because it's not just the foundation for parents. It's the foundation for all of us. The idea of prove God's love is to go show people what God has done. To prove to them that God's love is real. That while we were yet sinners, while we were still broken, while we were still this disgusting mess, he came and died for us. And you look at these statistics and you see 36% of the children, they don't even believe the Bible's trustworthy. Only 20% think that it's important to tell people that truth. those numbers have to change. And the only way those numbers will change is if parents, we start making it a priority in our homes. So my challenge for you this morning is this. Set some goals for yourself. Put some disciplines in practice. If you don't pray with your children, start there. If you do pray with your children, maybe pray as a family. Say, you know what, for the next 30 days, I'm going to pray. Let's pray every night with our family. Maybe evenings are too busy. You set a goal, say, all right, in the morning, all right, we're going to get up, and it's summertime, so that one may be tough too, because everyone's, you know, all the kids try to sleep in as long as they can, but find something that works for you. If you're praying with your family, you're praying with your kids, but, you know, you're just struggling to have a devotion time for yourself even, you know what? Bring your kids involved. Bring your kids as a family. Hey, you know what? For the next 30 days, let's all together, just 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 5 minutes, whatever. Let's open the Bible. Let's read some together. Why? Why are we doing this, Dad? Because this is trustworthy. This is important. This matters. This is not just a book. We have to know this so we can tell other people. Why tell other people? Because they if they don't know, then the consequence is so severe. I mean, you have friends, right? You have kids you go to school with. You want them to be saved. You want them to know God. Yeah, it's important. Well, for your kids to believe it's important, it has to be important for you. To have a future-proof family, you have to take the future-proof option. You have to make God's word the foundation of your home. You must read it. You must talk about it. You must teach it. You must look to it for instruction, for answers. Make it a priority. Have the proper perspective and take on the responsibility that God has given us as parents to do what only we can do for our children. Will you pray with me? God, it is my prayer wholeheartedly that over the next several weeks, as we pull out other passages in your word that should motivate us and should fire us up to go be the parents that we're supposed to be, and not just people with kids, but Christ followers who are concerned about the next generation, and not just the next generation, but the next generation to follow. Father, may every person in this room, as those that were here earlier, commit to you today to build a future-proof family, to make sure with confidence and certainty that their children know how important your word is, value it, want to know it, want to know you, and want to tell others about you as well. God, may we as parents prove your love to our kids so that they prove your love to their peers and to their kids and so on and so on. Give us the passion to be the parents that you've called us to be. And we pray that in Jesus' name, amen.